And peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome and good morning. I do have a couple of announcements this morning. I draw your attention to the opportunity insert, which lists for you all the activities going on in church this week. But I just want to highlight a couple of things. As you know, our theme for Lent has been forgiveness. And our two gatherings where we had a conversation about forgiveness on Wednesday evenings were so successful that we've added a third. And so this Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, we will again gather in the meeting house for a conversation facilitated by Reverend Eileen Epperson on the topic of forgiveness. So I hope you'll all join me for that. I want to thank the 26 people who contributed their time and effort and love and good works to feeding 130 hungry and homeless people in Bridgeport on Thursday night. What an experience we had. They really have it organized down there, and we were truly the servants. They told us what to do, and we did it. And our hearts were filled with joy. So we'll have another opportunity to do that sometime in the future. Our souls thirst for God in a dry and weary land. We seek God's power and glory in this sacred space. Here our souls are satisfied as with a rich feast. Together our mouths praise God with joyful lips. God offers us steadfast love and a covenant relationship. We are called to be faithful witnesses and leaders. We come to meditate on the living God. We come to seek inspiration and empowerment to do what God asks. Come, let us worship God together. Please join me in our prayer of invocation and confession, which is printed in your bulletin. We come before you, gracious God, seeking what money cannot buy. Only you can provide nourishment for our souls. There is no other source of meaning in our mixed-up world. We can find no fountain of strength or sustenance apart from you. Surely you can be found where two or three are gathered together. As a community of faith, we call on you, believing that you are nearer than our next breath, more available to us than we can think, more caring than we ever dare to imagine. Uphold us now that we may worship on wings of joy. We have been tempted, loving God, to go our own way without reference to eternal truths. We seek our own gratification rather than the well-being of all your children. We compare ourselves to others and find their failures, but seldom discover our own shortcomings. We seek to build our lives by our own limited design rather than by your larger purposes. The ground on which we stand is crumbling under our feet. O God, forgive us and grant us a firmer foundation. We turn to you now in silent confession, seeking your mercy, forgiveness, and grace. God grants us strength to overcome temptation and offers us a second chance to produce the fruits of repentance. Receive these gifts from God who is faithful, in covenant with us and with all people. Open yourselves to the continued guidance of the Holy One, for God's steadfast love is better than life. God's mercy is abundant. God's provision for us is extravagant. God's ways are higher than our own. Praise God with joyful lips. Let us sing praise to God.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son. Good morning. Today's responsive reading is Psalm 63, verses 1 through 8, which you will find on page 648 in your pew Bible. O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. My soul is satisfied as with a rich feast, and my mouth praises you with joyful lips. For you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings I sing for joy.
My soul thanks you, your right hand upholds you.
Today's Old Testament reading takes place just before the Babylonian exile and addresses a community that desperately needs assurance of God's favor and hope of restoration. God speaks to Israel and offers to them an abundance of food and reminds them the offering is because he keeps his promises as the covenant he made with David. Hear now the reading from the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verses 1 through 9, which you can find on page 838 in your pew Bibles. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no money, come, buy, and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me. Eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen, so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Amen.
Please be seated. And at this time, any second graders and younger who would like to go to Sunday school with Mrs. Collins may go ahead. Have fun. God offers us a way of life that satisfies. God invites us to a life of meaning and purpose. What cannot be bought, God freely gives. Let our offerings express our thanks for all these gifts. The morning offering will now be received.
Thank you.
we present to you now, O God, we have received from your hand. We give so the hungry may eat and the thirsty may receive pure water. We share to send the good news of your word to those who have not heard. We invest in just causes that your mercy may be known among all people. Most of all, we give because passing on your gifts in generous response is necessary to life. It is in Christ's name that we give. Amen. In today's New Testament reading, Jesus confronts the idea that natural or human-initiated disasters only befall the sinful or the evil. He challenges the self-righteousness of his followers, calling them to repentance. He reflects in parable on God's mercy that gently waits for us to wake up and start bearing fruit. He is on the journey to Jerusalem, experiencing both the honor and the dread inspired by a prophet. Hear now the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 13, verses 1 through 9. At that very time, there were some present who told him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. He asked them, "Do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will all perish as they did. Or those 18 who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will all perish, just as they did." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and I still find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil?" The gardener replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year, until I dig around it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." Here ends the reading from God's holy word. May he add to our hearing and understanding his blessings. Amen. God of infinite goodness, throughout the ages you have persevered in claiming and reclaiming your people. Renew for us your call to repentance. Surround us with witnesses to aid us on our journey, and grant us the time to fashion our lives anew through Jesus Christ, our Savior. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. I'm going to start today with a question. How many of you, I'm going to ask you to raise your hands, how many of you were raised in traditions other than the Congregational Church? Just look around for a second. Okay, that's it. Thank you. So I ask this to demonstrate two things. First, our church is one that welcomes people from all different backgrounds. And second, many of us, most of us, were not raised in this church, so we might be unfamiliar with the structure and the protocol and the history of this church. So today, I'm going to take on the role of teacher. And I want to provide a lesson about the Congregational Church, the United Church of Christ, and what it is that we believe. Perhaps this will be a review for some of you, and perhaps for some it will be new. But I think it's always important that we know who we are and what we stand for. This will be, as you will know, a much abbreviated history, but I hope it will spark an interest in you to learn more about your church. After Jesus died, We'll start there. After Jesus died and was resurrected, his followers worked hard to establish a church honoring his teachings, following his way. And remember that Jesus was a Jew, and his ministry was focused on calling the religious leaders to be mindful of the biblical truths, the commandments, and honoring God. Jesus' early followers struggled with all sorts of persecution under Roman rule. They were speaking the truth to power, and that was not appreciated. That all changed in the year 313 when the Roman Emperor Constantine converted to Christianity and issued the Edict of Milan, proclaiming tolerance of all religions throughout the empire. The Romans continued for centuries as the major force in the church, led by the Pope. Popes were seen as the primary authority in the church, deriving their power directly from the first Pope, Peter. And the Pope's been in the news a lot lately, so I know you've all heard of the Pope. In the year 1054, there was a split in the church. This was the first split, with the Eastern Orthodox Church establishing its center at Constantinople, and the Roman Catholic Church establishing their center in Rome. They continued on that way for about 500 years. And then in 1517, a Catholic priest named Martin Luther began a protest movement calling on the church to return to the authority of Scripture. He argued that the church had lost its way and had turned away from God. Martin Luther's motto was sola scriptura, only Scripture. And paramount for him was the message of Paul, that persons are justified by the grace of God and faith alone. Luther's protests became known as the Protestant movement, hence where we are today, and its many followers took different paths, reclaiming the centrality of the Bible in their Christian worship. So today, the Protestant movement has been broken into many different denominations. Our church, where we are, was originally the Congregational Church. And then in 1957, we entered into covenant with three other Protestant denominations, the Evangelical, the Reformed, and the Christian, to become the United Church of Christ. Our unifying call, taken from John chapter 17, is Jesus' prayer that they may all be one. We are a united and a uniting church. So I want to share this morning some of our beliefs that are outlined in the founding documents of the United Church of Christ. We believe in the triune God, God the Creator, resurrected Christ, Christ as the sole head of the church, and the Holy Spirit, who guides and brings about the creative and redemptive work of God in the world. We believe that each person is unique and valuable. It is the will of God that every person belong to some family of faith, where they have a strong sense of being valued and loved. We believe that each person is on a spiritual journey and that each of us is at a different stage of that journey. We believe that the persistent search for God produces an authentic relationship with God, engendering love, strengthening faith, dissolving guilt, and giving life purpose and direction. We believe that all of the baptized belong body and soul to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. No matter who, no matter what, no matter where we are on life's journey, notwithstanding race or gender or sexual orientation or class or creed, we all belong to God and to one worldwide community of faith. All persons baptized, past, present, and future, are connected to each other and to God through the sacrament of baptism. We baptize during worship when the community is present, because baptism includes the community's promise of love, support, and care for the baptized. And we promise that once we give it, we won't ever take it back. No matter where your journey leads you, once you're baptized into the community, we will love you for the rest of your life. We believe that all people of faith are invited to join Christ at Christ's table for the sacrament of communion. And just as many grains of wheat are gathered to make the one loaf of bread, and many grapes are gathered to make the one cup of wine, we, the many people of God, are made one in the body of Christ, the church. The breaking of the bread and the pouring of the wine reminds us of the costliness of Christ's sacrifice and the discipleship to which we are called. In the breaking of the bread, we remember and celebrate Christ's presence among us. Along with a cloud of witnesses, our ancestors, family, and friends who have gone before us. It is a great mystery, and we claim it by faith. We believe that in essentials, unity, in non-essentials, diversity, and in all things, charity. The United Church of Christ has no rigid formulation of doctrine or attachment to particular creeds or structures. Its overarching creed is love. Love and unity in the midst of our diversity is our greatest asset. We believe that God calls us to be servants in the service of others and to be good stewards of the earth's resources. To believe is to care, and to care is to do. We believe that the United Church of Christ is called to be a prophetic church. As in the tradition of the prophets and the apostles, God calls the church to speak truth to power, to liberate the oppressed, to care for the poor, and to comfort the afflicted. We believe in the power of peace. We work for nonviolent solutions to local, national, and international problems. We are a people of possibility. In the United Church of Christ, members, congregation, and structures have breathing room to explore and to hear, to decide for themselves, for ourselves, what it means to be Christians. Today's reading provided a rich reflection on our Christian beliefs. Isaiah conveys God's deep commitment to be in covenant with us. He says, "I will make you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love." God's covenant with us is the model that we use to be in covenant with the other churches and settings of the United Church of Christ. We are in relationship, not beholden to or subject to the authority of. We are in covenant. We honor one another. We support each other. We pray together. Isaiah reminds us to pay attention to what it is we hunger for. Perhaps the point of Lent, we're now at the midway of Lent, and perhaps the point of Lent is for us to adjust our sights so that we at least understand what we should hunger for, or perhaps what we do hunger and thirst for in our deepest being. As the body of Christ, we hunger and we thirst for justice, for mercy, for peace, for healing, for acceptance, and for love. And not just for ourselves, but for all of God's children. Jesus' message today reminds us that each of us is capable of producing these fruits, but perhaps in different ways and at different times. Some need a little more manure than others. We are a community of honor, a community of trust, and a community of love. We believe in the heart of the biblical message, and our lives are directed by the Word. After worship today, as I mentioned, you'll have an opportunity to learn about the work of the committees that carry out the work of our church. Everything that happens in the name of the church is through us. It's all through the work of our committees. Our own energy is what makes the church. Each of you, in covenant with one another and with the church, is asked to commit time each year. And again, every person and every life is different. However, everyone has something to offer. I ask you to take some time after worship to talk with the committee representatives and determine where your gifts and talents might best serve the church. And then let the nominating committee know what you're interested in. Don't make them chase you down. Or don't hide thinking, oh, they don't know who I am, so they won't ask me to do anything. Seek them out. Let them know. One of the greatest joys of being part of a congregational church is that we have complete autonomy. We are in charge of ourselves. You know, I remember as adolescents growing up, myself and my children as well, saying, oh, when I'm an adult, I can make the rules. I'll do what I want. Well, now we're in charge of ourselves. You can do whatever you want. But with that blessing of autonomy, comes responsibility. I saw a great visual this week, a chart that compared the consumer church with the missional church. The consumer church is when the church is seen as a dispenser of religious goods and services. People come to church to be fed, to have their needs met through quality programs, and to have the professionals teach their children about God. People in the consumer church identify themselves by saying, I go to church. The missional church is a body of people sent on mission who gather in community for worship, community encouragement, and teaching from the Word, in addition to what they are self-feeding themselves throughout the whole week. People from the missional church identify the church by saying, I am the church. I believe that my covenant with you includes the responsibility to lead you on the journey to becoming a missional church. We are the church. I would ask you to join me in praying together the words of our statement of faith. It's on the back. I love this. It's glued to the back of your hymnal. Somebody took a lot of time at some point to glue this to the back cover of your hymnal. Now, this is called the Statement of Faith. This is our founding document. It's been changed a little bit over the years, but this defines the United Church of Christ. And I want to make sure that you're all familiar with it. So join me together as we pray. We believe in you, O God, Eternal Spirit, God of our Savior Jesus Christ and our God, and to your deeds we testify. You call the worlds into being, create persons in your own image, and set before each one the ways of life and death. You seek in holy love to save all people from aimlessness and sin. You judge people and nations by your righteous will, declared through prophets and apostles. Jesus Christ, the man of Nazareth, our crucified and risen Savior, you have come to us and shared our common lot, conquering sin and death and reconciling the world to yourself. You bestow upon us your Holy Spirit, creating and renewing the Church of Jesus Christ, binding in covenant faithful people of all ages, tongues, and races. You call us into your church to accept the cost and joy of discipleship, to be your servants in the service of others, to proclaim the gospel to all the world and resist the powers of evil. to share in Christ's baptism and eat at his table, to join him in his passion and victory. You promise to all who trust you forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace, courage in the struggle for justice and peace, your presence in trial and rejoicing, and eternal life in your realm, which has no end. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto you. Amen. Let us pray. O God, hear us this day as we recommit ourselves to you. We want to serve as Christ served. We want to love as Christ loved. Grant us the power to live out our covenants with grace. Hear our prayers this morning for those whom we love. We pray for Dick and Teresa, for Don and Gloria, for Bill and Kit, for Robert and Claude, Bob and Becky, Laura, Toby, Mark, Greta, Lucille, Jane, Peter, Michelle, and Warren. We pray for Allie. May each one feel your healing power. We pray for those who grieve, especially the family of Teresa Stone and Jahu Blades. May their pain be lessened by our love. We pray for our brothers and sisters throughout the world who share our Christian faith, and for those who follow a different path to you. May each one know the goodness of your love and the beauty of your creation. We turn to you now in the sacred silence of this meeting house with the prayers of our hearts. Jesus taught them to pray in these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
seated. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. You who come to me shall not hunger. You who believe in me shall never thirst." In company with all who hunger for spiritual food, we come to this table to know the risen Christ in the sharing of this life-giving bread and cup. This table is open to all who seek the peace that Christ brings. Come to this sacred table, not because you must, but because you may. Come not because you are fulfilled, but because in your emptiness you stand in need of God's mercy and assurance. Come not to express an opinion, but to seek a presence and to pray for a spirit. Let us pray. Holy God, we praise and bless you for creation and the gift of life and for your abiding love that brings us close to you. We thank you for revealing your will for us in the giving of the law and in the preaching of the prophets. We thank you especially that in the fullness of time you sent Jesus, born of Mary, to live in our midst, sharing in our suffering and accepting the pain of death at the hands of those whom he loved. We rejoice that in a perfect victory over the grave, you raised Christ with power to become sovereign in your kingdom. We celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit to gather your church, by which your work may be done in the world and through which we share the gift of eternal life. With the faithful in every place and time, we praise with joy your holy name. Holy, 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 God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory, O God Most High. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God, Hosanna in the highest. Bless, therefore, by your Holy Spirit, both us and these gifts of bread and wine, that as we receive them at this table, where we offer you our faith and praise, we may be unified with Christ and with one another, and continue faithful to the tasks for which Christ has chosen us. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, was at table with his friends. He took the bread, and he gave thanks to God, and he broke it. And he gave it to them. He said, "This is my body, broken for you. As often as you eat this, do so in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup, and he gave thanks to God, and he gave it to them. And he said, "Take and drink, for this is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink this, do so in memory of me." Ministering to you in his name, I offer you the bread and the cup. Come, for all things are ready. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ, bread broken in love for you. Take and drink. This is the wine of our joy, flowing as a gift of God's Spirit into our lives. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have once again shown us your love by bringing us to this meal. We go from here renewed in faith, renewed in courage, and strengthened by your presence. Thank you for loving us so tenderly. Thank you for challenging us to know you better and to receive you more fully. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Seated. I couldn't help but notice, and I have to note, that our worship service today was led by a woman minister, four women deacons, and a woman reader. Not to say that we don't love and value all the men in our church, but I think that for those of us that think back to perhaps another time and look at the history of our church, there's a lot of places where that couldn't happen. And so I celebrate with joy in my heart the contribution of men and women, both acknowledged equally, to this, the body of Christ. And now, my friends, go out into the world, remembering that God's steadfast love is better than life itself. God's mercy and pardon break through the clouds. Call on God in the midst of each day's tasks. Meditate on God's presence through the night. God is our help in all times and all places. Praise and thank God. And may the blessings of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and forevermore. Amen. Fair.